everyone. How are you? Korean Buddhism, seven lessons. It's identity, culture, and history by Korea Dharma Master Venerable Wonung Bogum, Dr. Richra. Korean Buddhism must be reformed. The point made by intellectuals outside of Buddhism seems to make some sense. I think that there is a need to fairly and strictly investigate their claims and ground, rather than treating them as if they are outsiders who are attacking the monastic order unconditionally, even within the monastic order. After investigating, a solution must be sought according to the result. And if disturbance is caused without any basis, it is necessary to truly punish it. Intellectuals within Buddhism believe that they need the courage to respond together and raise counter-argument before remaining silent, or to speak positively and campaign together. The purpose is that Korean Buddhism should not go astray. Perhaps the most important point is that Korean Buddhism should be an order centered on monks and nuns. That's correct. I believe that such extreme condemnation and movement are taking place in the hope that Korean Buddhism should operate in a pure manner as an order of monks and the general public comprised of monks and lay people. Although we cannot 100% guarantee that all Sangha perfectly follow the Vinaya precept, when a Sangha pursues that goal, it is believed that Korean Buddhism operates healthily and shows its presence. If there are hidden secrets, injustice, and injustice disguised as a hypocrisy, the life of such a religious group will not last long. If there is a defect, he should take off his clothes, return to his home, and practice Buddhism. He should not stay on the edge of the Sangha and be a hypocrite by deceiving himself. If you are honest, shouldn't we follow in the footsteps of our precedents? Monks and nuns who demonstrated their bhikkhu spirit and carried out a movement to purify Buddhism? To be honest, it is true to some extent that Korean Buddhism is now rife with plutocratism, power, conspiracy. This is because I personally agree that the criticism and demands of external Buddhist intellectuals, reasonable actions. Otherwise, there is no alternative but to raise suspicions and quickly reveal the truth. On this earth, the religion called Buddhism doesn't exist only in Korea. Even if it exists only in Korea, it is just others' perception that I feel that Korean Buddhism, which has emerged in Korea over the past 10 years, is somehow a little strange. Although I don't know, I'm planning to develop discussions, secretly hoping to form a consensus, thinking that it might be quite effective. In fact, over the past 10 years, things that go beyond common sense have been happening in our Buddhist community, especially in the Sangha. Looking at what is happening in the so-called first and second orders, the first and second order, which represent Korean Buddhism, I'm concerned about whether it is really okay. It means that it rolls away. Another thing that is most worrisome is the absence of an opinion leader group that sees this phenomenon, organizes from a critical perspective, except for a very small number of internet media. I would like to diagnose that the media function in Buddhist community is already paralyzed. It feels like the media has been reduced to a watchdog that only represent and protect certain groups. Academic journals and cultural journals are also unable to keep quiet about current issues in Buddhist community or religious orders, and even seem to have a tendency to form an academic cartel to block the expression of devised ideas and opinions. All areas of our society are showing the same trend of stagnation and stagnation. In this way, it is extremely doubtful whether Buddhism can truly function and serve as a religion for living beings. When you go to places like Burma, Thailand, Cambodia, and Laos in the south, southern Buddhist countries, you get the impression that the daily lives of monks are truly a pious practice group. The most important thing is that the Sangha is alive. The fact that Buddha's Sangha, which preserves the original form of Indian Buddhism, is being reproduced as is, gives a deep impression that Buddhism is alive and inherent, since it's the permanence of the Buddha's Sangha. The faith of Theravada Buddhism seen through the history of Southern Buddhism has endured constant twists and turns, but the reason it has survived until now is due to the will of monks and their faith in the Buddha's Sangha. Buddhism was introduced to China via North India and the West region, the current Xinjiang region of Central Asia, and has existed as one of the mainstream religions in East Asia for the past 2,000 years, leaving behind a long history in Buddhist culture. In the history of Buddhism in East Asia, Buddhism, which developed on the Korean Peninsula, was persecuted and stagnated during the Joseon Dynasty. It seemed to have regained its name as Buddhism only a century ago, but it was influenced by Japanese Buddhism. So what happened? The name Buddhism was restored, but the Sangha began to wear Japanese colored clothes, and the purity of monks was lost, transforming into Decha Buddhism. Decha Buddhism means marrying monk. I mean, Japanese Empire let Korean monks get married. That's why now in Korea we have bhiksu and married monks. Despite this, there was a group of monks who maintained the duties of the Sangha. And after liberation, through these groups, Korean Buddhism was able to restore the proper Buddhist Sangha. However, in the past 70 years, it is a truly unfortunate self-portrait of our Buddhism that some devils dressed in hypocrisy have secretly taken advantage of the purity of this monk and monks. However, would it be okay if these groups took over power and money, paralyzed the duties and function of the Sangha, and led the Sangha's culture to a strange way. Thank you very much for your listening. Thank you.